Hey, good morning, everybody. Welcome to our Revelation study. In case you missed it yesterday, we're doing things. This is probably going to blow some people's minds in the way we approach this book, but we're going to try to do it. My focus is on doing it in a way that the original hearers heard it so that you could come into that way. A few years back, a friend of mine, I live in central North Carolina. It's called the Sand Hills area, south of Raleigh, north of Fayetteville. And a few years back, a friend of mine who grew up in this area was visiting in the mountains of North Carolina, and he and his family went to a church there, and they ran into something they'd never seen before. No, not snake handling, wrong direction. It was a certain style of preacher, and for those people who weren't raised in Appalachia, it's called Appalachian folk preaching. And Appalachian folk preaching is very emotional and rhythmic and extremely loud. I mean, the speaker will start talking and he'll be calm, and you'll hear him gradually work his way up in more and more passion, more and more yell. He comes, and at the peak, it is just yelling. It is just, and it's really loud. And then he'll reach this crescendo and he'll drop. And thus saith the Lord. And then he'll usually pull out a handkerchief and wipe his brow, and they'll be really calm for just a few seconds, and then he'll start again on this building in intensity and passion, and it goes up and then stops and goes back down again. And he does that. The entire sermon is made up of these hills and valleys. And my friend was like, what in the world did I just see? What was that? And most of you have never seen anything like it. And you've seen the guy doing the brothers, that's similar, but it's a little different in the fact that it's this up down thing. And so my friend thought it was the strangest thing he'd ever seen. And what is interesting about that is, of course, Appalachian folk preaching. I'm from West Virginia. I grew up in Appalachia. A little church about 5 miles from here. I just checked to see the distance from this house. It's about 5 miles from where we are right now. And I say little church, I mean it's little in every way you can define little. I would say their auditorium holds 30 people-ish. That's putting everybody in their seats. It's 30. I don't know if you can get 50 people in that room or not. I mean, it would be definitely not social distancing. Maybe 50 people in that church. And their pastor is one of those. He does Appalachian folk preaching. It's not common here, but he's that style. And what people don't know is every summer I take about a month off. And not this summer, but normally I take a month off in the summer. And it's not uncommon for me to sneak in there 1 week. For me to just slide in right at 11, pull my truck in, get out, go sit down in a pew by myself. My family wants to go to our church, and I'm on vacation, so I can't really go to our church when I'm on vacation. It messes up my whole brain. And I'll slide in there, and I'll sit on a side pew right by myself, far away from anybody else as I can get. And I'll listen to that guy, and he's not highly educated, because that's not how that style works. He'll make his share of grammatical mistakes, but he'll do that, and I just settle in and I am home. Because my pastor growing up, until I was about probably 12 or 13 and my dad became the pastor of the church I grew up in, that's what I grew up with. They don't call it Appalachian folk preaching where I grew up, they call it preaching. My dad always wanted to be that style preacher, but he's such a teacher that it never really worked for him. But it's his favorite style. And if I take my daughters and we see anybody like that, they're scared to death of it. When they were little, we took them and they would be exposed to that, and they found it terrifying. But for me, it's home. It's natural. It's a rhythm that I understand. I don't emulate it at all, I don't think, but I understand it. It's comfortable. It's home. And a lot of you, when you pick up the book of Revelation, it's a lot of yelling and screaming and weird stuff, and you think it's weird, just like my friend who saw the Appalachian folk preaching thought that is weird. You think the book of Revelation is weird, and for you, it is. But one of the things we talked yesterday about, the two primary confusions people have why we don't get the book of Revelation, understand it. One was we misunderstand prophecy. And we don't understand that prophecy isn't about predicting the future. It's about changing the present. That's all. That was yesterday's message. Lesson. But we misunderstand the genre of apocalyptic, which is what Revelation is. And we don't understand that if you took somebody from that era, from that time, from just toward the end of the Old Testament era into the first 100 years of the New Testament era, so that's probably about 600 years, during that roughly 600-year stretch, apocalyptic literature, like Revelation, was normal. It was something that people read. It was something that people actually listened to primarily. And it was a normal thing for those people. So when they heard John's book of Revelation, they didn't freak out and say, boy, that was weird stuff. They went, oh. What they might say is, this is the best example of this genre. They wouldn't use the word genre. This is the best example of this style of writing that we've ever seen. Because it is. It's amazing. And it is probably easily the best of that thing. But it was, in fact, common, almost normal for them. They would have heard it as just, oh, not Appalachian folk preaching, just preaching. Matter of fact, let me show you this right now. This is a book called Old Testament Pseudepigrapha. This is volume 1. I own volumes 1 and 2. And if you want to know what a geek I am, I own volumes 1 and 2 of Old Testament Pseudepigrapha. I own it because I asked for it for Christmas one year. Scouts on. And this book right here, this thick, is full of apocalyptic literature and testaments. It is full of stuff that sounds just like Revelation. I don't think it's as good, but it is. That is the style. It is that stuff. So we need to understand, as we're going into the book of Revelation, as we're working our, we're already starting to work our way through it very slowly to begin with, that this is not weird to them. This is a very normal genre. Here comes the largest truck in the world. Okay, so let me just read, and let me show you how this works. Because if we're going to understand the book of Revelation, we have to understand a little bit about, we have to put ourselves in their mind frame and try to understand the concept of apocalyptic. Now listen to this. Verse 4, the book of Revelation starts, it's got like three pieces. It starts out with a general introduction we read yesterday, which talked about the revelation from Jesus Christ. Okay? And then we get to verse 4, and there's another thing that starts out sounding very familiar to us. It starts out in verse 4, John, to the seven churches in the province of Asia, grace and peace to you. Now, does that sound familiar? Yeah, it sounds just like, we just finished a study in Colossians. It sounds just like the start of Colossians, except instead of Paul, it says John. Because all the New Testament letters start out, okay, name of the author, who it's to, then a grace and peace. It's all starts the same way. And this starts like a normal letter. John, to the seven churches in the province of Asia, grace and peace to you. Now listen, it's going to switch and turn just slowly to tell you what kind of writing it is. Grace and peace to you from him who is and who was and who is to come, and from the seven spirits before his throne, and from Jesus Christ, who is the faithful witness, the firstborn from the dead, and the ruler of the kings of the earth. And we're starting to slide into, and he's telling us this is going to be apocalyptic literature. He's letting them know it's going to get even stronger when we read in verses 6 and 7. It's going to get, whoa, this is apocalyptic. But understand, like I said, it's common stuff. It's not uncommon in the Bible. The book of Daniel, a significant chunk of Daniel, you know, the stuff where there's statues and rocks coming from the sky and break, all that's apocalyptic. The book of Zechariah, which you may or may not have read, is one of the last books in the New Testament. It's a ton of it is apocalyptic in its style. Ezekiel has a lot of it. Isaiah has some. Joel has a lot. Jesus even uses an apocalyptic style of that genre in Matthew 24 and Mark 13, among other places. Paul is so familiar with it because it's really a Jewish, it's in the Jewish context primarily. It's so common that Paul will sometimes just shift into it for a few verses. In Ephesians chapter 1, he hits it in verses 15 to 23. If you go back after we've talked about apocalyptic and you read Ephesians 1, 15 to 23, you're going to go, oh, yeah. He just shifted into that genre for just a little bit, and then he shifts it back out. Okay, he does it in Thessalonians. Peter does it in 2 Peter 3. Hebrews 12 has some apocalyptic concepts to it. And like I said, this whole book, which is gathered from that era, is full of it. And they didn't get all of it. That's what they found. Okay? So, Let's talk about apocalyptic. Let's see what it means. It's going to be interesting. Trust me, you're going to like this, probably. Okay? Let me tell you something. Number one, it's like prophecy, but not exactly. Okay? It's like a subcategory under prophecy. And for one thing, in normal prophecy, if you go back to Isaiah, normal Isaiah or Jeremiah, it's going to be talking to people who are, to use the traditional word, they're backslidden. Prophecy is normally written in the Bible to people who have moved away from God and calling them to repent and return to God. But apocalyptic is going to talk to the people who are faithful and tell them to keep going. Okay? It sucks right now. The whole thing of apocalyptic is it sucks right now. If you think about it, the era of apocalyptic, it goes from the exile, for close to the exile when they were getting kicked out of their own country, until they got kicked out of the country again. So it's like they're always oppressed, and it's a language of oppressed people crying out. A really good example to think of this would be the Negro spiritual songs. Because they're written by people who are oppressed and subjugated, and there's a certain way that nobody knows the trouble I've seen, no one but Jesus, nobody knows the trouble I've seen, no one but Jesus. That concept that nobody knows what, I am going through a really rough time, but Jesus is here. And that's what's going on here. Faithful, persevere. The prophecy tends to be local. This specific nation, this specific tribe, this specific region, they've worked away from God, and God's going to use natural judgment. He's going to send plagues and locusts and whatever, storms, whatever. But apocalyptic, it says, yeah, God's going to take the whole earth and wipe it clean. He's going to zap the whole planet. That's apocalyptic. This is just interesting. Prophecy, if you know this, prophecy is normally poetic. Most of the book of Isaiah is prophecy. Most of the book of Jeremiah is prophecy. Ezekiel. Most of the prophets is poetry. The apocalyptic is narrative of these real heavenly visions. That's how they do it. And while prophecy promises restoration and a future blessing, apocalyptic says, no, it's not. Prophecy says, here's the world. Okay, you went this way, God's going to do this to bring you back where I want you to be. That's prophecy. Apocalyptic says, you're here and God's going to go, bam! And there's going to be a new heaven and a new earth. It's a huge difference, okay? So that's a big part of it. One other big part of apocalyptic is that it's oral. It is meant to be read aloud. If you remember in verse 3, of Revelation 1, it says, blessed is the one who reads aloud the words of this prophecy, and blessed are those who hear it and take to heart what is written in it, because the time is near. Blessed are those who hear it. And I got an amazing story about this. Some of you guys, Kevin and Benita, I'm pretty sure you were here for this. About 10 years ago, I was teaching on prophecy. I was doing the book of Revelation, and I had this idea in my head that I was going to take one Sunday and just tell the story of the book of Revelation. I was just going to describe it. I was going to put it in my words and tell the story. And I came across that verse in verse 3 where, like I said, blessed is the one who reads aloud the words of this prophecy, and blessed are those who hear it and take to heart what is written in it. Okay? And I read that verse, and it wasn't an audible voice, but it was clear as a bell. God said, do you believe that? Do I believe blessed is the one who reads aloud the words of this prophecy, and blessed are those who hear it? No, I don't believe that. Because what it means is, blessed are people who sit down and read this book out loud to other people who listen to them read this book out loud. And I'm like, no, I don't believe that. I don't think that'd be blessing at all. I think that would probably be boring. I don't think anybody would sit still while somebody just read. But there was a conviction God was giving me. He's like, yeah, I meant what I said. Blessed are those who read it, and blessed are those who hear it. So what about instead of describing the book of Revelation to the congregation, to the church on Sunday, why don't you read it to them? And he and I fought for a little bit, because I'm not the most obedient guy in the world. And eventually I came around to his way of thinking, because he's like, you know, God. And so I skipped over the first three chapters, and I started in Revelation chapter 4. And I literally, you can check, you can ask, there were people who were there. I just started in Revelation chapter 4, verse 1, and I started reading. And I read the entire chapter 4, chapter 5, chapter 6, chapter 7, all the way to chapter 21 or 22. I can't ever remember which is the end of the book. I think it's 21. I read from chapter 4 till the end of the book. That was my entire service. That was the entire sermon. I made like two comments the entire time. I'd simply read it. And everyone who was there Because you can do that in 45 minutes. And I spent the week not working on a sermon, but practicing reading that book. I just read it over and over and over so that I could read it with meaning and with passion and with the right kind of emphases. And I read it, and the people who are there still talk about it. I had to do it two services too. That was really nerve-wracking. I got to do this once, and what if it bombs the first service? What if everybody hates it? And it didn't. That verse was true. Blessed are those who heard it. Like I said, it was an event that people who were there still talk about. I don't plan on doing it again unless God just smacks me again, because it's scary and weird. And everybody I told I was going to do it, every pastor, they said, "You're an idiot." And to this day, if I tell somebody, a pastor that I did it, they look at me like the elevator don't go all the way up for you, does it? And maybe it doesn't, but that verse is true. Blessed are those who hear it, because it was written. John wrote it to be listened to. And I think a great thing we do is we try our best to make it fit into our standard of how we think and act, this apocalyptic book, and we miss the point so badly. We stomp around it. Like I said, we make a chart out of a movie and act like that should be really meaningful and powerful, and it's not. And so, wanting to catch the once we get through the first three chapters, because you'll see why when we do it, we'll go first chapter is going to take about 3 days, then we'll take each of the seven churches and each of them get a day, because that's really cool study, and then we'll probably go about a chapter a day, because I want you to see the big picture. I want you to see what's coming, because when you see it as the big picture, apocalyptic is telling this big story and taking you along for the ride. And if you micromanage it, you'll miss so much of the big story. You'll miss the forest for the trees, as they say. Okay, so let's go ahead and talk about how to understand. How do you hear it? Okay, like I said, we have to remind ourselves continuously. The people who heard it didn't think it was weird. They did not find it odd. They said, "Oh, that's it." Matter of fact, like if you're there's certain genres of movies and genres of books. Like I would say, a lot of the sci-fi fantasy stuff is closer to apocalyptic than a lot of anything else, because it is kind of odd and it's a different world. But if you're used to reading in a fa fantasy n novels, you go to another fantasy novel, you're right at home. You're going, "This is normal." And so it's like that. So we need to understand the ancient listener, what they were going through. They were suffering. Okay, they were in trouble. Recognize this book specifically was written after the fall of Jerusalem, easily. So Jews had been oppressed for a few hundred years, and then they got their temple destroyed in like AD 70. And so they are oppressed. They're a minority everywhere they go. They are being stomped on, and they're the people who are listening to this book. Okay? And you need to be sensitive to that. This is the people we're listening to. They are under attack from Rome. They are being eradicated. You probably don't know this piece of information. The Romans killed as many or more Jews on a percentage basis as Hitler did. Did you know that? You probably didn't know that piece, did you? No, the Romans, during their entire history, wiped out as much a high percentage, I believe like a third of the population of all Jews were killed under the Roman occupation. Okay? And so that's what they're going through. I need to look that up. I'll tomorrow look it up and tell you exactly the number, but it's a crazy high number. And the purpose of the apocalyptic book is to take that person who's down here and lift up their spirits, because we want them to persevere. We want them to keep moving. We want them not to quit in the middle of all this disaster. We want them to keep moving. So we're going to build them up through this apocalyptic literature, and that's the purpose. Is you are down and you are discouraged. If you think of, nobody thinks of this. If you're discouraged, we always send you to the Psalms. You know where you might want to go if you're feeling really discouraged? Revelation. Just do me a favor. Don't try to read it one little bit at a time. Start in chapter one, sit down, and you can read the whole thing in an hour and read it. It'll change your life. Reading the book of Revelation in one sitting will change your life. It really will. It is incredible, even if you're not used to that. So we've got to talk about the listener, what they heard. We've got to be ready for the setting of the crisis. And we've got to be ready for some seriously symbolic language. A lot of this stuff is symbolic, because if they write a book that says the Romans are idiots and we can't wait for God to zap them, what are the Romans going to do when they read that book? Oh, so maybe instead of saying the Roman Empire, I'm going to put a symbol on that. Okay? And so it's very symbolic, lots of numbers. There's poetry, metaphors, hyperbole, irony. A lot of numerical patterns that repeat. You'll see that a lot in Revelation, all the sevens, and then here come the tens and the threes and everything else. So let's go back and read what we already read, and then just keep going from 4 to 8, and you'll see what I'm talking about as far as the symbolism and the numbers and everything else. John, to the seven churches in the province of Asia. Seven is one of God's favorite numbers. He created the universe. How long did that take again? Oh yeah, seven. Okay, grace and peace to you from him who is and who was and is to come, from the seven spirits before his throne. Well, that's symbolism and numerology. And from Jesus Christ, who is the faithful witness, the firstborn from the dead, and the ruler of the kings of the earth. Now the next verse, 5 and a half and 6, is actually pretty normal stuff you'd read anywhere. To him who loves us and has freed us from our sins by his blood and has made us to be a kingdom and priest to serve his God and Father, to him be glory and power forever, forever and ever. Amen. And then it switches into full-out apocalyptic mode. Look, he is coming with the clouds, and every eye will see him, even those who pierced him, and all peoples on the earth will mourn because of him. So shall it be. Amen. I am the Alpha and Omega, says the Lord God, who is and who was and who is to come, the Almighty. And so now we've got all that symbolism, all those numbers, and you're going to see those things come around, and there is a purpose to that. There is form of meaning to that. There is a way of using that to draw you in, okay? So the one two more points. One I've kind of been hitting on a lot is you need to, as we're doing this, you need to remember that it was oral. It was meant to be read aloud. Okay, I have this picture that so often we take our modern mindsets and we come to this book that's meant to be read aloud and in big pieces, and we go in and we dissect it and we cut it in little bitty pieces. And to be really honest, a lot of the people who dissect it end up killing it. It's like they're doing an autopsy on something that's supposed to be a living. You're not supposed to be cutting it up. It's not a terrible thing to look at it very, very closely. I'm not saying that, but you got to keep it alive while you're doing it. Okay? If you're going to dig into the book of Revelation with a knife, you need to make sure it's surgery, not an autopsy. Because way too often we cut it up so big, so little tiny pieces that we miss the big picture. And as soon as you lose the big picture, you lose the power. This book is so powerful. It is one of the most powerful to read books in the Bible. If you read this book, like I said, you read it in one sitting, the power of the book just jumps off the pages at you. So make sure you remember it was oral, it was meant to be read aloud, and they didn't read one verse or one sentence and stop. They read from the whole book at once. And it's meant to be heard and absorbed. And we'll talk more and more about that as we go. But just letting the whole thing wash over you instead of trying to be that modern person who breaks it into little bitty pieces and misses the power of it because they're so busy with the minuscules. Okay. And finally, I've already kind of hit on this, but apocalyptic literature like Revelation was meant to be a message of hope. Now, this is where it's important that we kind of probably place the book of Revelation, because we talked about it being Jewish origin. It was a Jewish style of literature that John adapted and then perfected, to be really honest about it. This is an amazing example. It's the best example of this writing style. John wrote it during, most likely, a Roman persecution. One of the Roman emperors who decided to crack down on Christians came down hard on him. So now the Christians are oppressed and they're beaten down. And when you're oppressed and you're beaten down, it's easy to want to give up. And this book is the you do not give up because, as you know, you may have heard this repeated joke, you know, I read the back of the book and we win. Okay, that's in a nutshell, I read the back of the book and God wins. That's the message of this whole book. And he wins because he's so much more powerful. We're going to go to huge battles that get set up, and God just goes and wipes out the opposition. I mean, you're going to see just how big God is from this book. This may be the best book in the Bible. If you struggle with recognizing how big God is, this might be your best book for you to read. If you're feeling like God is just a little tiny thing, read this book. It puts God right back on his throne. It puts Jesus right back on his throne. And it's awesome for that. But as we go through this, we're going to do our best to make sure, like we did today, that we're getting into the mind of the people that, who are there. Okay? He is coming in the clouds. He's coming riding in. His chariot is clouds. And we are, you know, here comes the hero riding to the rescue of his people. That's the image of the, we are oppressed. We can be discouraged. Don't be discouraged. Jesus is coming to rescue us and to set all things right. I'm the Alpha and the Omega, says the Lord God, who is and was and who is to come, the Almighty. Okay? And hopefully, if I do this right, and hopefully I'll do it right, by the time we're done, you're not going to be going, Revelation's a cool book, as much as you're going to be going, God is an awesome God. Because that's the message of the book. Okay? All right, come on back tomorrow. We'll try to finish chapter 1. You guys have a great day.